Good morning and welcome to Morning Java, brought to you as always by our friends at the GetGo Cafe and Market, where they are open in business and enthusiastic about your arrival 24 hours a day. They're still humming. Ramon.
Yes.
I got you shown up here. This is my Green Lantern Christmas sweater. It's the only bad Christmas sweater that I've got. What's the worst one you've got?
Worst one I got was... I don't know. I had a reindeer one, man, that was just like out of control for no reason. It was a reindeer one. I was just like, you know what? It had like light bulbs on the antlers and stuff. I was like, you know, I'm going to rock it anyway.
Out of control for no reason is the best description of a sweater I've ever heard.
It is, man. And I had one with what was Jesus Christ on it and it said, it's my birthday. So that one was
Oh, jeez. Okay. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Before we get into Steelers versus Bengals on Monday night.
Yeah.
I want to get into Steelers versus Bengals other times.
I like this.
I can picture where exactly, because you always had the one stall at the end of that middle
on
stack
the corner.
There, over the corner. Yeah. You were in like the position of authority somewhat. And you had Pounce next to you, and Marcus Gilbert was down on the far end.
Yeah, and Dave and Al were on the other side.
Dave and Al are on the other side for some reason. Yeah. Never understood that, but I'm going to start with Dave and Al on the other side.
Okay.
Because I went over to them after one of those gory games, one of those just horrible, horrible games. Not the Shazier games. That's horrible for a different reason. The other games. And I remember going over to them, and before I even had a chance to ask a question, Dave turns around and goes to me, "What was that? What was that?" And Allie, who's been in combat, says, "I couldn't do that every week." He said that to me. He said, "I couldn't do that every week."
Yeah.
Man, those games. I don't know. Sometimes we're people like me are guilty of hyperbole with stuff like this, but not with that.
You know, it was. It's one of those, when you did this right here, that's the feeling that it was. It's like, I cannot believe this is how the game is. And not to say that the rest of the league games are soft or the game, you guys don't play a tough game back in my day. No. It wasn't that. Every week is a go hard type of week. But the extra side of what Cincinnati dished out for no other reason than to prove a point or to say, well, you might have beat us, but we did this. That was the points of those games where you're like grabbing your hair afterwards and you're like, why are you the way you are? You know, like those were the games, man. And just the small stuff. And I'll say this too. The guys I always respected around those games, it's always Geno and Dunlap, because it was these reasons for them. They were in it for the purpose of the game. They were in it for, man, I'm trying to beat a really good team. I'm trying to show that we're a contending team.
Mm-hmm.
But your Burfics, your Pac-Mans, your Drake Smith sometimes, and you'd even have some of the running backs that would just do some stuff. You're like, come on, man. Like, not you. I hadn't seen you do. And I think that what it was, the reason Al and Dave felt that way was this. We didn't see any of that extra stuff against other people. Only against us. And that's where it made you be like, come on, guys. Like, you're not going to win. Just let it go and let's just play the game cleanly. And they, for whatever reason, I don't know what Marvin Lewis was giving those guys or whatever he told Burfict to do or just the freedom that they were able to just do some stuff. Because if I'm being real, it was a couple of years they was probably better, good enough to beat us.
Yeah, that's fair.
They didn't do the execution part of being bad guys right, if you feel what I'm saying. And that's where that's where they were probably like, man, I can't do this every week because I'm putting my health and the way of just trying to win this game dealing with you guys. And we do that every single week. But with them, it was like, all right, there's a little bit extra going on for no other reason than I can't even really explain it.
No, but you just said something that I'd not heard anybody say about these games before, and that is that they weren't doing it to other teams. And I'm sure that's something that I've never heard anybody say that. And I guess now as I think back, like I wasn't studying the film of Cincinnati the way you guys were in advance of those games. So you got to see that. You got to see that Perfect wasn't completely losing his mind on every team he faced.
No,
these guys weren't.
So it's crazy. You see little stuff here and there, but it wasn't as blatant as it was in our games. Like the extra dive on a pile, or the extra, like, throw the quarterback to the ground, the way he tried to do Ben, or, you know, the sideline running, twisting Le'Veon's leg, like that type of stuff. And the verbal aspect of everything that was going on, the words don't matter, but it's just like some of the stuff he said was like family matters, was like, you know, just over the top, like non-football. The thing about the league is this. It is one hell of a fraternity. DK, I want to beat the hell out of whoever I'm going against. That was my number one goal. One, do what's right by my team. And secondly, do not get embarrassed. And me not getting embarrassed meant that I'm going to try to bash you any chance get.
You have no choice. That's the job. That's the job.
Exactly. And you see that happening. But in those games, it just became like, yo, is this even football? You know, and part of it, it wasn't. It was – I usually have a saying, you know, the real gangbangers, the real thugs, the real hard guys, like, they don't go to college for 4 years. You know, they don't do this. There's only one or two instances where we can call somebody in NFL a killer, a stone cold, like, yeah, that's a badass guy. I don't want to cross the street with him. Everybody else committed themselves to the cause of going to college for a little while. They have some structure in their life. They understand what it means to be a professional for the most part. Yeah, you'll have a mess up here and there, but guess what? I'm not trying to kill you literally on the field. I'm trying to inflict pain on you within the rules, but it's not going to be the stuff that we got from them, man. And that's what made it so sad, because it was really during the prime eras of, let's say, 14 to 17, a little bit of 18. Like, it was good. It was good on good.
It should have been their best years. The last thing I have on this subject is I remember when, well, we all do. We all remember when JuJu clocked perfect. And you can say what you want about the nature of the block and everything else here. He stands over him. And but who do you remember who it was that came up to JuJu and said, knock it off?
Was it me or Dave?
It was Dave, and you were right behind him.
Yeah.
Okay. Dave went up to him and almost pretty much like shoved him.
Like, yeah.
JuJu. And he was like, because that reminds me of what I would hear from you guys afterward, was that you had to be this strange combination of defensive, meaning protective, of yourself and your health, but also aggressive to show you weren't taking it. And then within that, not crossing the line yourself.
Yeah.
What is that? And for Dave to be that aware of that, to go up to JuJu, who, by the way, I had no problem with the block, but that's just me. Maybe just because it was who.
You know what? If you run around the neighborhood doing drive-bys and, you know, taking people out, at some point the neighborhood is going to bond against you and be like, you know what? Sorry for them, but that's the game. And I think the way Perfect played this game for a while, as I said, the NFL is a fraternity. Football in general is a fraternity. So seeing that, I know it was a tons of players that said something to JuJu about that hit. And it wasn't, hey, you were scumbag. It was more like, thank you.
Yeah, way to go.
But to Dave's point, though, I think I guess when you humanize the football game of what that hit was, though, it's kind of like, okay, we got ours in. All right, JuJu, move on. It wasn't
he's out. Dude is out.
Yeah. And JuJu being a young guy, honestly, that's what you expect from him, man. You see this dude doing that. He's taking a shot at JuJu, his counterpart. He took a shot at AB. At some point, man, you're going to get got. And that's what that moment was for him. And Burford could probably laugh at that and say, you know what? Yeah, I might have got once. I might have got once, gotten got once. But I inflicted a lot of pain on a lot of people. So, hey, he live and die by that. JuJu, I think, made money off of those shirts. So, hey, so be it.
All right, speaking of JuJu, everybody around here is talking about JuJu. They're talking about him dancing on the other team's logo before the game. There's a lot of people that don't understand, A, why he does it, B, why some of the Steelers' older players, the veterans, don't say something to him about it, why Mike Tomlin doesn't do anything about it. Anything at all from you here? Because now you're free to actually talk about stuff like this now.
I'll say this day and age, all NFL players, from linemen to some quarterbacks, all do everything they do on social media. Yeah. They win or lose, post pictures no matter what, period. If they win it, they're posting the pictures probably 5-15 minutes after the game, which is fine too. Mm-hmm. That's just the game. The teams do the same thing. I felt like what Juju's doing, he did it when nobody else was around. He's out there warming up. That was part of his little routine. Maybe he was warming up, catching balls, bam, in the middle of the logo, do his little dance. And the third part, the other part of it is these players make so much money doing this self-promotion stuff.
Yes.
That
yes.
I don't think it's a big thing. So if you're telling me as a player that's doing the same thing that I'm doing, you can't go do that. Well, no, you can't tell me I can't go do that because you're doing the same thing, just in a different way. And if you're an older player, let's say if you want to bend and go say something to him, which he has that right to. I think Ben kind of recognizes that the game has kind of changed a little bit. The branding of players is kind of wild these days. Teams do it. We do it. And also, the way he was doing it, I didn't see it as a means of disrespect, too. I'll say that a guy that stepped back from this situation – I didn't recognize that they were agitated about it until Josh Allen said something. Well, I heard Josh Allen say something in the preseason. I mean, in the pregame warm-up, I guess, before the game. That's the only time. Nobody else, to my understanding, has kind of said it. If that's the fuel they needed to, you know, to help push through that win, that's all right, too. But I saw what Juju's rebuttal was, that he's not going to stop doing it. And the thing is, we as fans, teammates, Steeler Nation has celebrated Juju. It's been a few to moan and groan and complain about it, but he's doing his job. Up until 2 weeks ago, nobody could do any wrong on that team. So I say this to say, of the guys of things you can point fingers at in the last game, he's not one of them. I didn't see it as the Terrell Owens going to the middle of the Cowboys logo. I didn't see
that. Well, that was in the game.
Yeah. I mean, so he sprinted after a touchdown out to the star. Yeah, that was different.
I didn't see that. My thing is this. I've been on the side of where I've tried to pull real guys back in and say, hey, don't do this. You shouldn't do that. And you kind of get greeted with a little bit more resistance when you do stuff like that. The thing is this. If he falls flat on his face and don't make anything of it after doing those type of things, then that's when you say, hey, check yourself. All the little extra stuff that you're doing, that's not helping us win. Juju's been a steady Eddie when it comes to this team this year. I think we all can agree about that. For him to be, I guess you can look at him and say he's the number one guy on this team. I think he's the oldest as far as wide receivers in that room. He's done his job. He hasn't complained. He's been everything you wanted him to be. It's just that the recognizing that social media has kind of changed it for him. The 150 people that dislike it, or the 2,000 people that dislike it, there's on his profile 180,000 that love it.
This is true.
I'm not saying get with it or get on. What I'm saying is the game has changed. You're not going to have Bettises.
There's no question about that. Let's take this from the other perspective. You mentioned Josh Allen. It was the video, and it was actually put out by the Bills. The video, it wasn't some Salem viral 17. Thing. Like, the Bills put this out, the official Bills account, and all they did was bleep out the F-bombs. But what it was, for anybody who didn't see it, Josh Allen basically brings his I think it was his wide receivers and tight ends around him. Yeah, he had them at the end of the tunnel there. And he tells them, hey, let them dance and we'll blah, 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 blah. Do teams really get fired up over stuff like that? Or is that completely manufactured? I mean, you're the Bills. You haven't won a thing like ever. And you're about to take the field for an actual important game. Did you really, really need that to get fired up?
No, I didn't.
No.
After the fact, it was cool to hear him, and you can rally. He won over a lot of people in the sports world by saying or getting caught by saying that, but he didn't need it. If there was anything that Juju did, it was just doing it. It just gave him a little bit. And if we're going to be honest about it, let's not act like they lit it up either, the Bills. Even from that pick six is what took him over the top. It wasn't anything else in the game. So we're not going to – let's not paint that up. I mean, we still a nation won't paint it up, but that's just what it was. It was something for him to say. Besides, Juju's not the one sacking him. Hell, it's Cam. It's TJ. So that was the least of his issues.
Steelers versus Bengals with no Joe Burrow. I don't know who Cincinnati's quarterback is right now.
DK.
Oh, wow. You don't either.
I can't. The quarterback I knew played there last week. The Red Maybe Rifle.
It's Kenny Andy Anderson
Dalton plays for Dallas now.
Andy Dalton, Boomer Esiason. Who's quarterbacking for them? But look, they don't matter. The Steelers need to right themselves.
Yeah.
And you know, we've talked a lot about the running game.
Mm-hmm.
We've talked a lot about the need for an intermediate slash deeper passing game.
Yeah.
At some point, Moan, those two things, you know, they're not
– Yeah.
They don't exist in separate universes.
I know. No.
So which comes first? Which comes first? What do you got to do first?
It's a couple things that you can take out of it. It's number one, I won't be coming out of retirement to help the run game or anything like that.
Well, we've got that out of the way.
I had to do that, DK. I'm sorry.
Hey, listen, Kevin Dotson is his injury doesn't appear to be as serious as we thought. So you're off the hook on that one here. And there's actually even a possibility that Matt Filer, if this runs, if they make a deeper run into the playoffs, that he could come back because he did not have a complete tear. So not to make light of the guys who are playing left guard in your place, but they look like that situation is not going to be as bad. If they can get Kevin Dotson out there, they actually have some depth.
Yeah, you know what was wild, though? I did have a prominent guy in the locker room reach out. I was like, Mom, man, like, seriously, could you play right now?
Good for you.
Like, legitimately reached out, and I was just like, man, if I had to, I would, but that's not in the plans for me right now. But to get the deep ball and the running game,
Wait a second. That had to feel good. Come on. Admit it. Come on. You're like, oh, man, they still love me. This is good.
You know what? And you know what? I've heard that aspect. Well, I didn't get that side of it, the player side, until this past week, meaning like, Mon, we could use you. The part that I've gotten the most from the team, man, has been, Mon, we miss you in the locker room. We miss you being able to pull stuff together. Like, I wasn't in the pamphlet a captain, but the stuff that I did behind the scenes, like, you've seen some of the stuff that I did of, like, try to take control of. Like, that part of it, they've kind of alluded to that a little bit. Not to say that they're not getting it, but you know me, I try to be a guy that kind of brings everything together.
You're the
man.
Bridge.
That's one thing
you're the bridge. I think of you when I think of you in that regard, I think of Chicago. I think of the anthem flap. Well, okay, see, it took you a second, but I think of Chicago right away because I have Dave. I can say this stuff now, but I have Dave DeCastro. Yeah. Basically pulling me by the wrist going because he was so angry. I'm not telling you anything you don't know, but he was so angry about the way the whole thing went down, and you can tell he wanted to tell me so much more than he did. And he didn't. And then we look over at you, and here you are, Mr. Popular. You're surrounded by all the cameras and microphones, and you're standing there holding court and making everything seem calm. Marquise is in the shower or something, anything just to stay
trying to get
away from
out
us.
Of there. Yeah.
Just, right? And of course, Alejandro Villanueva was nowhere in sight.
Yeah.
But I know what you mean. That would be something that they, especially in a time like this, where clearly, I don't want to call the offensive line in crisis, not when you're getting that kind of pass protection.
Yeah.
It's not good right now.
Yeah, and whether it's to break the ice or whether it's just to, you know, mend things, because I kind of wrote it in my article this past week on your site, was because we went through this, and you know we went through this. I know we kind of veered off from Cincinnati a little bit, but people rather hear about us anyways. Geno's on IR. That's all that matters about Cincinnati.
That's right. We don't know who the quarterback is.
All right. But that's one of the things, man, that I always wanted to bring was like being seeing that the defense, the way they are right now, Bud is down. We lost Devin, and then I think Spillane is down a little bit right now. It's just a few things going on. And if I was going to say anything to the guys on offense, which I don't know if they've already said it before, Ben's a really good leader also, and so is Marquise. And, you know, there's guys in positions also, but I'd probably overly reiterate to them that, hey, look, we got to start picking up our end of this deal. We know how it feels to be where the defense is at, meaning they won't admit it, but the way the offense pushed along, the way the offense just 42, 38 points here and there to win games, like the defense is feeling that right now. Keeping the team at 17 points and still not winning the game, like the onus is on the offense. I mean, not necessarily just the offensive line, like everybody doing a job and just saying, hey, we got to make this happen. That window, DK, it closes. Like, as far as going to get that championship, and if there's one team that really, I believe, can do it, it's Pittsburgh because of defense, man. We've seen trending lately that Kansas City hasn't been able to close out games, so they need a third down here and there to finally get a game. If that offense can have the feeling that they had in 2017, 2016, to say, hey, for the next last three regular season games and the next three or four postseason games, if we can tap into that with the defense that we have now, even minus Bud, minus Devin, Rob a comeback, Vinny get off the COVID list, like it's we begged and prayed for defense the way they the 2020 Pittsburgh Steelers is, DK, and they have it. And you got Ben back. And if that's what I would like harp on the guys about. We've seen this show happen before. And before long, you crack and you come up short. Because why? It's hard to be the ones that's pulling the chariot the entire time.